So.
Okay, well, please welcome our next speakers, Dominik and Niels.
Yeah, so welcome to our talk, Too Young to Rock and Roll and to Contribute. This talk will be about raising a bit of awareness to those who either develop free software or give legal advice to people developing free software, because there is one target group or user group that has bigger difficulties to overcome legal obstacles in using and contributing to free software than any adult has. And the first part of the talk will be held by my young colleague Niels. Yeah, so it's your turn.
Thanks. So first, something about us, the Techheads. We are the probably only free software youth organization, and we are based in Germany, but we are working internationally. The Techheads e.V. is run by children, which is very important for us. And yes, we are doing technical workshops around FOSS based on the peer-to-peer system. For example, we did the Frog Labs at the FOSSCon in Bonn, in the west of Germany. And our goal is to build up a FOSS community among children and to connect children, schools, and FOSS projects. So now something about me. I'm Niels Hradek. I'm 13 years old. I'm from Düren in Germany. It's in the west of Germany, like Bonn. And I'm a student at the Stiftisches Gymnasium Düren. My interests are organizing events, video and audio editing, and I go swimming, I'm playing the piano, and I do Wing Chun. My goal is to create a FOSS community for children and to help children share their opinion.
And a few words about me. I'm Dominik, or Nick for short, the founder of Techheads EV. Yeah, in my day job I am a system administrator, but at Techheads my goal is to build a growing and hopefully sometime very big community around free software among children, and not only that, but also integrating children in the larger free software community.
I'm going to tools use, so the tools which are used. First, we have tools in use at computer science classes, for example IDEs like Scratch, Greenfoot or Tommy, and editor software, etc. Then we have tools in use at other classes, for example audio and imagine software like Audacity, MuseScore or GIMP. Then we have web browsers, etc. Also, we have games and other funny stuff because services are an important part of the privately life too. We are teaching in class with software. So, free software can be used for a lot of stuff. Free software can be used for teaching programming. Free software is based on contributions. So free software can be used to teach programming by contributing. To do that, we need services which don't discriminate minors and where minors are part of the community. But what do children say on the topic? We asked the students if they would like to get a chance to change the software they use for themselves and others. And 83% could imagine contributing. I mean, it doesn't mean that they would really contribute, but they can imagine, and I think that is that proves enough that we need such services which don't discriminate minors. So our conclusion here is that free software that has children as a target group, either by intention or by coincidence, should be aware of that and should be open to the young folks.
Okay, thank you, Niels. We already have heard something about meta teaching. I want to elaborate on this a bit more. Is this working? Can you hear me?
Yeah, cool.
We regularly see in our workshops where we have 20 or 30 children sitting around and they start hacking on a project like a mini video game or something like that. And the tools we use, some of them are developed by our organization itself, but some are also developed by other communities. Hey, drop it.
I apologize that the wire on the mic is not reliable. Let's try this.
Okay. It's better?
I think you
have to stand still and maybe put it in the bottom. Yeah, okay. It's really flaky, apparently. Okay. So, all right. And then they wanted they had like a bunch of 300 items in inventory, and they said, so if I have to loop over this and drop all the items from the inventory, then this gets very slow. Can't I just drop all items or something? And no, they couldn't because the framework didn't allow it. And half an hour later, they were already a bit used to using Git and stuff like that, and half an hour later we had a patch allowing to do this, and all the teams were able to use this new feature. And this is very cool, at least in my opinion, but there are some things that can get difficult for children. You all know when you use some free software or contribute to it, you read the license terms, you maybe look at the license terms of the build tools you use, or you just trust a third party like Debian or something that they only include free software. There might be a contributor agreement, and then, which has become more and more important during the last years, there are terms of use of some platforms that are used. There might be a CI platform, and then there's the development platform where the Git repository is hosted and where issues are tracked and all stuff like that. And at the end of the day, you have like a stack of legal documents that you have to go through or you just ignore. Yes, you do. Okay. Yeah. But every adult has the chance to read this, maybe understand it, maybe ask the legal dev room to help them understand it, and in the end they can decide whether they agree or they don't. A child might also be able to decide whether they agree or they don't, but they cannot click that agree button because they are not legally allowed to do that. They can get your parental consent for some things. Yeah, but many commercial platforms are based in the USA, and in the USA there is this thing called COPPA, the Child Online Privacy Protection Act. And it is a bit outdated, in my opinion, and it is really, really difficult to apply and understand. Just to align you with the outdatedness of this thing, if you want to send parental consent to an internet service provider, you have to send a fax and put your signature on it. Yeah. Okay, but this thing says, if you provide an online service that shall be used by children under the age of 13 years, then you must never ever add features like selling premium features or raising any private data from them. Now, a major platform for Git repositories based in the USA has a term in the terms of use saying all children under 13 years, you have to stay out. And they blame this on COPPA. Personally, I don't think they have to. They said they say their lawyers told them they have to. This is very difficult. So, I have to catch up with my slides here. Sorry. Okay. What we wish you to do when you choose your tools and platforms and licenses, please check them for everything that might not be only a question of taste or ethics, but also whether all the people that use your software and might be contributors can understand it and are legally able to agree to it, and that they don't discriminate against any age group. When we try very hard to not discriminate against religion, ethnicity, gender, all that stuff, but there's also discrimination against age groups. I'm not saying that they do this intentionally, but this happens. It might also not look like a major issue, because it's hard to imagine that people as young as that will ever do a valuable contribution to software, but they do. Please try to imagine that they actually do and that they want to have the possibility to do so. I want to quote from German law. I translated this. If there is a lawyer in this room and I translated it wrong, please don't listen. A minor requires parental consent for any declaration of intention that contains not exclusively legal benefits. This is from German laws, but it might be a good guideline when you check terms for applicability to children. If there is anything in this that touches a legal right that you normally have, like copyright, personal rights, if these terms cut these rights and ask you to drop some of them, then this is not then minors cannot legally accept these terms. Yeah. It is very hard to find services that do not have such terms. It's very hard, but if we all try and we all maybe try to convince people to be more open to that, which is also the reason why we are talking to you, also we are not really into legal topics, I think we can get on a very good way to that. Okay, so please keep in mind that there might be contributors to whom drawbacks in terms of use or licenses are not a question of taste or ethics, but of legal possibilities. So please keep these obstacles as low as possible if you can. Yeah. Okay. For those of you who are teachers or no teachers, there is a service called EduGit. This is a shameless advertisement because we operate it ourselves because there is need. This can be used in classes. The terms of use are so simple that you can spontaneously skim them, read them with the students, and they should be acceptable by everyone. So if you are looking for such a service, you might want to try this. I also checked the new Salsa service from Debian. Looks okay as well, but obviously they don't allow experiments, but only real free software projects, not something that you do in class or anything. Okay. Yeah. I'm now showing a slide that you might want to take a photo of or look up later when we upload the talk. I'm not really sure whether I am allowed to show it here. If you have any way to support us and like the idea of supporting children in the FOSS community, there are some ways to do this. We and especially the children in our organization are very happy if they can attend more free software conferences and share our ideas with the world. I am removing the slide in 3 seconds. It's one of the last slides in case I get thrown out or something. Okay, also please applaud to our sponsor Tarent, who enabled the children. There's also Philip, who gave another talk in the RTC Dev Room, who enabled them to come here. And yeah, thank you for listening. What are some experiences you have made or thoughts you had about this topic, if there are any questions from your side?
So this legal problem with children agreeing to essentially bad terms, it's almost like what's going on here is that the law is protecting children from a kind of pressure that all the rest of us adults are exposed to, yeah, to sign up things that we don't really want to agree to, or maybe that we don't read, in order to get what looks like a useful service. And maybe one answer to this is that we should be less ready to push the kind of platforms that have the kind of legal departments that do this kind of thing. We should be trying to be more tolerant of and more open to
Yeah. Yes, thank you. So the idea was that the laws that prohibit children to accept some legal terms are made to protect them. And I don't know whether I got you right, but I think the baseline was that we should in general try to keep the obstacles very low and maybe also try accepting patches and issues in other ways that do not need such consent. Right?
Yes.
Like by mailing lists and stuff like that. Yeah?
I see that the techkids.org site has some terms of use on it.
Yes, it has.
Are those
are
suitably friendly?
Those are designed to be acceptable by minors. They are longer than I wish them to be, but they contain, even for the simple stuff, they contain enough explanation. For example, we need a date of birth because most... Niklas, what is a Jugendamt called in English?
Child Protection Office.
The Child Protection Offices require us to track because we allow access to adults and children. So, and we have to track who is a child and who is not, and we need to collect the birthday for this. And of course, we give an explanation that is understandable for parents and children to that. But apart from that, the terms of use are designed to be understandable and acceptable by children. Right. Yeah?
So I have a question for Niels, and that is, the things you're doing sound like a lot of fun for kids. I mean, the games and other projects. Do you think that kids understand this idea of software freedom? Do you think that kids get that idea?
I know that kids get that idea because... So the question was if I think that kids understand that idea with software freedom and free software. I know that kids understand that because, for example, in my class, there are kids which think, ah, free software, it's great. And in other classes of members of the tech kids are two in their classes which understand those this free software. And I think that if children don't understand that software freedom, that they should should understand it. So we should do something that children understand this free software, because maybe then there will be legal terms too.
Do you have any documentation for organizing?
actually work with and encourage children to come along to events?
We don't, but there's some ticket in our OT. Okay. Should make t-shirts with that. The question was whether we have advice for projects and for conferences in order to help people bring their children to conferences and to design legal terms that allow that. Yeah. We don't actually have this in written form. There's some ticket in our endless OTRS system about that to create such texts. But what we do is when we find things that are difficult, we... do I have to get up?
No.
If we find things that are problematic for children, we try to communicate with the people with more or less success. Last year, we actually did something that did not make us very famous with many FOSDEM visitors because we criticized the free beer booth that actually handed out beer to our children. And we asked them to maybe put a bit more control on that. okay. Any more questions? Do you see anything? Because you know I'm blind.
There. Over
yeah.
there. Yes.
No, as far as I understand, I've been a teacher for 30 years. Education forbids copying. For me, copying is the basis of education. Contagion is the means that work best for education. So what do you think about that? That we should change the evaluation procedure in the school, in the exam, to encourage children to cooperate, to collaborate, and not forbid collaboration?
Thank you. Okay. Yeah. I actually. Oh, should we be? So the question was that in education there is the idea that copying is a bad thing. Not only copying, but reusing and remixing things, like. I'm not sure what aspects you mean. Probably that every student has to do their have to put their own ideas in works, and working together with others and sharing ideas with others only happens in a small part of assignments. Yeah, I actually think that being able to find pieces of work on the internet that are free and explain things and can be used to explain things to others that can be understood and that can be remixed to create something that fits the need in class or something is a very important thing to learn, and it's probably more important than knowing some texts by heart or something. Yeah, this should be done more often, of course. Niklas, what do we have something? This is our teacher in our organization.
Yeah.
So, if you have anything to share in regard of this. Welcome, the hidden speaker of Tech at CV.
Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So, I'm an English and French teacher, and we had this very question yesterday. I took my French school book out of my bag and showed my colleagues what I was working at the moment with, and I showed them that we were working on phrases and useful expressions for discussions, and I would never give my students a bad grade for using those expressions in a dialogue they write, so I would rather grade them on their creativity and ability to write a dialogue that makes sense and that is clearly structured and logical, and that's how you should grade software or programming assignments as well. So you should grade them on the creativity, on the readability, on maybe on the documentation and explanations that they can provide when they are asked about their software, and not on the amount of code they have reused from other sources.
I think that's a great point. And with that, let's thank Dominik and Niels.